Our next speaker is Dr. J. Naveen Kumar, Professor and Head, Department of Oral and Maxillofacial Surgery, Sri Ramachandra Institute of Higher Education and Research, Porur, and he is going to talk about setting up craniomaxillofacial practice.
Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Naveen. I'm not a tech fellow. So I'll be talking to you about setting up of craniofacial practice. And the best part of the lecture is that it's only going to last you 10 minutes. After which you can return to the respective pubs, either in this this hotel or the next one right next to Radha Bhakke. So I have a few questions myself to start with. The questions are, why do we need craniofacial surgeon? Number one. Now, is there a craniofacial surgeon registry in our country? Number two. And number three, most importantly, what happened to those 50 plus craniofacial surgeons apparently who attended the hardcore craniofacial hands-on workshop down south in the country in 2015 and 18? Are they in training or are they practicing craniofacial surgery? This is what I want to know. Yeah. So interestingly, 1/6 of the world's population is in our country. And the incidence of craniosynostosis is about 1 in 2,500 live births. We are not adding cleft lip and palate in this entity, it is purely craniosynostosis. Because if we add cleft lip and palate, it will become 1 in 700, which is even more disastrous. So, exclusive craniosynostosis happens in 1 in 2,500 live births. And 40% of these craniosynostosis patients are syndromic craniosynostosis, which means syndromic craniosynostosis definitely will have mid-face problems, which is a pure maxillofacial spectrum. Not that the other craniosynostosis patients don't have maxillofacial problems, they do have it. But the syndromic children invariably have maxillofacial problems. And then most of them are untreated. Now, our Professor K.S.R. in one of his articles in Financial Express in 2013 clearly said that there were, in 2013, there were only 10 exclusively craniofacial practicing craniofacial surgeons in the country, and all over the world there are only 100 surgeons. Now, even this, if this number had multiplied 10 times, even if we have 100 surgeons in the country today, it is still not enough to handle the 1 in 2,500 craniosynostosis that is happening. Now, that is the demand supply discrepancy that we are going through. Now, this is also validated in one more paper by Samuel Nordhoff in 2014. He also clearly mentioned that there are only 10 craniofacial, hardcore craniofacial units in the country. Now, why are there only a few surgeons? Long training periods. The neuroplastic ENT and other surgeons are unwelcoming, obviously, because it's our fault. There is a steep learning curve. There are high risks involved, that's what we think. There are obviously easier alternatives available for survival. So given a choice between placing an implant and charging 40,000 rupees and doing a mid-face advancement distraction and charging the same 40,000 rupees, obviously you want to select the easier option. Now, and then the other extreme is surgical heroism. Like I've had plastic surgeons or even our own maxillofacial surgeons say that I do my own craniotomy. Why? There are neurosurgeons meant to do it. You allow them to do the craniotomy. They'll let you do the 3 for 3. The specialty is multidisciplinary. You respect each other's profession. Okay? And most importantly, Laskin's paper in 2008 clearly describes the scope of maxillofacial surgery. He classifies them as 3 separate parts: areas of expertise, areas of competence, and areas of familiarity. Areas of expertise he mentioned as dental and lab procedures, pre-prosthetic surgery, stuff like that. Area of competence were PM joint, orthognathic surgery, etc. And areas of familiarity were cleft lip, palate, craniofacial surgery. So because the scope itself only mentions that you only need to be familiar with it, not many surgeons are opting for this subspecialty. Now, Samuel Nordhoff's paper in 2009 specifically clearly mentions in India the problem is there is lack of trained personnel. That is also because the training period is an average of about 5 to 10 years. 2009, the World Craniofacial Federation Foundation visited India and surveyed 3 large high volume craniofacial centers, one in South, one in Middle India, one in North India, and they found striking deficiencies common to all these three high volume centers. They were, they said the patient and public awareness is extremely low. I would add on to it, even the doctor's awareness is low. How many pediatricians or gynecologists at childbirth advise children to go for craniofacial consultation? No. Unless it is a severe Crouzon's or periodontal or Schein-Thrissartzen, they are not going in for craniofacial clinics at all. Minor plagiocephalies are just neglected. And the second point is they felt the transport facilities were very deficient in taking children from the rural areas to the urban areas. So, and he also mentioned about lack of subspecialist and specific training and the lack of hospital administration support. Now, isn't it ironical that stalwarts from the other side of the globe have to come and do study on our country and tell us where we are lacking and what we need to do to establish craniofacial practice, don't we know? Okay, so now how do you start craniofacial practice? You need to do certain investments. Invest in the four T's. This is my opinion. Invest in four T's. Training, trust, team, and time. Training, you know this paper recently by Sanjeev Kumar clearly describes the type of training available to become a maxillofacial surgeon. Countries like India, Southeast Asia, Nordic Turkey require only a single degree to become a maxillofacial surgeon. Countries like UK, Australia, New Zealand require a dual degree. Countries like France and Spain, eccentric people, require only a medical degree to become a maxillofacial surgeon and just a little bit of dental knowledge here and there. China is a separate league altogether. They just purely believe in training to help with your degrees. Stomatology, fine, do practice whatever you want. Now, this paper from Belgium, Raphael Denedai, clearly mentions that the public recognizes plastic surgeons only as craniofacial surgeons, obviously because it's coming from a plastic unit, they will only support themselves. Now, do you have a license to practice craniofacial surgery? Three separate papers, Wolf's paper, Daniel Laskin paper, and V. Khanna's paper, three separate papers are all saying that there are major differences in training, legislation and certification for craniofacial surgery and maxillofacial surgery practice worldwide. Our own legal expert, maxillofacial surgeon, Professor GP, says that there is no specialty called craniofacial in India. It's anybody's playground because there is no specialty register. You finish your MBS, you are eligible to practice whatever you want. As far as training is concerned, next slide is my perspective. So as training is concerned, you need to have a mentor. Okay? In my opinion, the mentor need not necessarily be the master of the technique. One only learns most of the times attitude from the mentor, not necessarily surgical technique. And in most cases, the mentor ends up facilitating or getting you across the right moment. My mentor is sitting right here. Now, the next point is trust. Mutual trust is essential. You have to stick to your surgical professional boundaries. Like if, for example, if the neurosurgeon insists on doing a flap elevation, allow him to do it. That is what he studied for. And there's no harm, no point in saying, I learned endoscope, I want to try my endoscope sometime as an osteosis. No. If somebody's trained for it, give them the room. That is all. It is better to grow with the other surgeons of the team rather than to grow beyond them. Now coming to the third point, the team. The craniofacial team consists of orthodontists, pediatric dentists, child psychologists, intensivists, social worker, and hormonal surgeon. So this is what the team consists of. It is not one-man show. Craniosynostosis is about a baby. Two people involved in forming one, many people involved in treating one. Now, the fourth is the time. The average time taken to become craniofacial surgeon is about 5 to 10 years after your legal eligibility, like for MBAs or whatever degree you have. There is a steep learning curve and you must be willing to take time off from regular dental, oral, surgical or maxillofacial work. The next paper is on general craniofacial surgery, September 2014, in which the Plastic Surgeons Association formed the Indian Craniofacial Foundation in 2012. They also realized that craniofacial care requires big and equipped team, frequent combined clinics and a lot of funding. Now in case you're not up to surgery but interested in craniofacial surgery, there is always scope for biomolecular research on craniosynostosis. So whose cup of tea is it? As long as you have the required training and understanding team, good infrastructure and funds, it is your cup of tea. Whether you are a craniofacial surgeon, maxillofacial surgeon, ENT, plastics, neuro, whatever you are, if you have the right training and team, it is yours. Okay. Once you're into it, what are the options available? You can get into private, you can get into funded centers, or you can get into a government setup. The private setups have lesser volume, but unfortunately there are lesser people to answer to, but there is high patient expectations, like I said. But in funded centers, you have better volume, there is more chance of training and upgrading, and relatively lower patient expectations. In government setup, you have more volume, but you need to motivate yourself. I will conclude by saying Isaac Newton's quote. It says, if I'm able to see further than others, it is only because I'm standing on the shoulder of giants. So these are the giants I've been standing on so far. Thank you, everybody. Thank you.